Well, happy Good Friday, everybody. It's great to see you all out here. Tonight, we're going to be looking at love's last word, word seven, Jesus' last word from the cross. This is a passage, this is a text that has really fired me up over the last few weeks of study. And so I invite you to, as we delve in tonight, there'll be times you may feel like you're drinking from a fire hose, but bear with it. I've done it. You've probably done it. I think we've all probably done it. We hit Wednesday in our work week, and it's hump day, right? Over the hump, powering toward the weekend. We're looking at the proverbial end. It's in sight. We're looking forward to downtime toward activities that, frankly, we enjoy a lot more than the daily grind. But you know, when you think about it, in my judgment, we seem to do the same thing with Easter. Bear with me a second here. We may subscribe and be interested and fired up by the pomp and the pageantry of Easter, the empty tomb, the celebration, and then we jump over Good Friday in anticipation. I'm going to invite us tonight, as we look at this last word, to linger a little bit on Good Friday. This is some important, important material. And I'm absolutely convinced that by lingering on Good Friday, we can more deeply appreciate and experience the empty tomb on Sunday. In fact, it has been said that you will never understand the resurrection. You will never believe the resurrection to any useful purpose unless you discern first the meaning of the death and have learned that therein and thereby the world's sins were borne by him. The sermon's going to be a bit different. In it, I invite you to join me as we briefly yet deliberately walk through and expound some of the events of Thursday evening and really rivet our attention on Good Friday, from sunrise to mid-afternoon, following our Lord from the upper room to the cross. We're going to do it in a word. We're going to use some pictures to show you a little bit of Jerusalem, the course that Jesus might have taken. But we just want to get some sense of what our Lord accomplished for us at such a cost, at such a price. So let's open with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you that we have the privilege of gathering together here tonight. And I ask that you would work on our hearts, do something mighty. Help us, Lord, to stop projecting, anticipating, and be able to just stop in our tracks and understand, perhaps more deeply than ever before, what happened on Thursday and Friday before Easter. Take our time tonight, Lord. Use it to your glory in your Son's name. Amen. So we're going to turn to Luke chapter 23, starting at verse 44. Here we read, "It was now about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, 'Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.' And having said this, he breathed his last. Now when the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God, saying, 'Certainly, this man was innocent.' And when all the crowds had assembled for this spectacle, when they saw what had taken place, returned home, beating their breasts. And all his acquaintances and the women who had followed with him to Galilee, from Galilee, stood at a distance watching these things." You see, despite Jesus' warnings, despite Jesus' admonitions, the disciples probably didn't have a clue when they entered the upper room that night. They might have just thought this was going to be another Passover celebration. They'd celebrated two previously with him. This may be number three. But something was different. Something was in the air. Now, unlike Da Vinci's depiction of the Last Supper, they gathered around what was a U-shaped table. They called it a triclinium, with Jesus at the head. And very interesting, we know that John was at his one side, and we believe that on the other side, the other place of honor, none other than Judas, was situated. So the Lord took common bread and in their presence broke it and said, "This is my body given for you." Now, if that didn't confound them enough, he grabbed a cup of wine, blessed it, and said, "This wine represents the new covenant sealed with my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in memory of me." Let's stop right now. Let's stop where we are. Let's take a moment and let's receive communion together. Can I ask the elders to come forward? The ushers to come forward and serve? Friends, at Northway, we have an open table. If you're a follower of Jesus, we invite you to partake of the elements and join us as we lift our hearts together. During this time, I urge you to reflect. I urge you to take your minds back almost 2,000 years to what it might have been like when Jesus picked up that bread at the Last Supper and began to utter these words to his disciples. Some of the last words he would say. So the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. After he had given thanks, he blessed it and said, "This is my body, which is broken, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." One of the things that I've always enjoyed, and I've talked about this from time to time, is the fact that, go ahead, ushers, you may serve. When we offer the elements, there are some manuscripts of the New Testament that say, "This is my body broken for you." I almost went there tonight. But you know what? Is that an accurate description of the Lord's Supper? Remember our Lord on the cross. Our Lord was on the cross next to two criminals. And while he was on the cross, as the day passed, the Roman authority gave word to break the legs of the individuals on the cross. Now think about that. I mean, is that just adding insult to injury? Why do you break their legs? Because as long as they had their legs under them, they could push up and they could gain a breath, somehow manage to outlast that time on the cross. So the soldiers went around and started breaking legs, broke the legs of the criminals. But when they got to Jesus, what did they find? Jesus was already dead. This is critically important in our understanding of what happened that day. Because Paul in 1 Corinthians talks about the fact that Jesus was our Passover lamb. That Jesus went and was the sacrifice for us. You know, if you go back to Exodus chapter 12, the Passover lamb had to be the choice of the flock, the very best, the unblemished, the spotless. Not a bone was to be broken. You didn't offer the one that was limping around the pen and probably wouldn't make it to the next day. You offered the one that was the choice, the prime, the best. Folks, tonight as we take communion, let us remember that Jesus Christ was our Passover. Jesus Christ was the perfect, unbroken Lamb of God. "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Afterwards, Jesus took the cup and said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Did you take yourself back? Did you think at all about what the tenor might have been in the upper room that night? You had Judas being told that the one who I give the sop to, he is the one who will betray me. Simon Peter being told, "You will deny me." When I think about this, I imagine the room became very silent, very quiet, foreboding almost. If there was a common thought, it probably was, what's going down? What's happening here? From the upper room, Jesus and his disciples traverse the Kidron Valley toward the Mount of Olives and make their way to Gethsemane, where Jesus enjoins them to stay alert, pray while he goes ahead and prays for himself. This is where Jesus fell to his knees, begging God, if it is possible, Lord, take this cup away from me. Three times Jesus went back, and three times he found his disciples sawing logs. This last moment, these last moments that they would enjoy with Jesus, they couldn't stand up to the task. They couldn't endure through the evening. They fell asleep. And then the Roman centurions appear. Judas plants a kiss of betrayal on Jesus. And Jesus is hauled off into custody after a brief skirmish with Simon Peter. The long night was just beginning to unfold. As the night falls, the authorities waste no time. They were hell-bent on getting rid of Jesus once and for all. Since his arrest Thursday night, Jesus is shuttled back and forth between Jewish and Roman authorities, arguments over jurisdiction and the like. In the wee hours of Friday morning, the Jewish authorities arraigned Jesus. Jewish law mandated that a defendant appeared twice, two separate trials before the Sanhedrin. We know that the second trial was probably perfunctory. It was meant to fulfill the letter of the law, but certainly not the spirit of the law. Jesus, of course, his conviction was upheld, and he was bound and sent to Pontius Pilate, the Roman prefect of Judea, to dispense punishment. Pilate himself was a man that was not known for his kindly disposition. This is a man that 5 years after Jesus' death was hauled back to Rome because of the brutality attributed to him. Okay? In lieu of blasphemy, the Jewish leaders bring Jesus to Pilate under the trumped-up charge of treason against Rome. All along, it had been very clear that the Jewish authorities' desire was that the Romans carry out the dirty work and carry out Jesus' execution. But things take an unexpected turn when Pilate realizes that Jesus is a Galilean. So Pilate sends Jesus to Herod Antipas, who is a tetrarch of Galilee, one of the sons of Herod the Great, and he adjudicates the case. Herod interrogates Jesus, but as you'll recall, Jesus gave him no answers. So the soldiers mocked him, contemptuously dress him in a robe, and send him back to Pilate. But once again, things don't go down the way the Roman authorities expected them to, excuse me, the Jewish authorities. Pilate, instead of levying the desired sentence on Jesus, declares him to be innocent and endeavors to free him. You see, the custom of releasing a prisoner on Passover is well documented. And in Scripture, we see it in Matthew, Mark, and John, and in some later manuscripts of the Gospel of Luke. This is called the Paschal pardon, the Passover pardon. But the efforts of Pilate are thwarted by the throngs that demand that Jesus be crucified. Pilate aims to secure Jesus' release by presenting the people with this choice. Release the notorious criminal Barabbas, or release Jesus. Worked up to such a fervor at this point, the crowd smelled blood and demanded that Barabbas be released and that Jesus be executed. Pilate then orders that his soldiers severely beat and scourge Jesus, 39 lashes, hoping that would satisfy the crowd. This was understood as a punishment in and of itself, but it was oftentimes seen in Roman law as a prelude to crucifixion. 40 lashes, depending upon who was giving the lashes, could be tantamount to the death penalty. So the Roman act of scourging consisted of taking a non-Roman citizen or a slave, tying them to a post and whipping them with knotted straps, which sometimes contained pieces of metal, pieces of bone. This was a horrendous penalty, so horrific that it was never imposed upon a Roman citizen except by the express order of Caesar. This brutal act was so severe that it could lay bone bare, consequently would shorten the time that an individual would spend on a cross. Now, some of you might remember back in 2004, Mel Gibson's movie, The Passion of the Christ. This movie was frequently criticized that it was too brutal when it described and depicted the scourging of Jesus. In point of fact, the thing was probably worse than what was depicted. Truth be told, it was much more ruthless than we might ever want to imagine. And even by this, the crowd is not placated. They wanted more blood. Pilate essentially at this point throws up his hands and gives them what they want. The Roman soldiers lead Jesus to Golgotha, also known as Calvary, the place of the skull, to be crucified. He would bear his own cross, which was the instrument of his execution. But due to the abuse that he had already suffered, Jesus collapsed under the weight of the cross, and the crucifixion still awaited. Simon of Cyrene is pressed into service to bear the cross the rest of the way to Calvary, where Jesus is nailed to the cross, hoisted and affixed to the upright, and the real vigil begins. Now, over the past 5 weeks, you've been treated, I think, to a great series focusing on the last words of Jesus from the cross. I've loved focusing on these rich verses of Scripture. I've learned a lot studying them as well. I've walked away with a deep confirmation that none of this was happenstance. God is orchestrating everything from his heavenly throne. If you don't believe me, consider the fact that this event and all the circumstances surrounding Jesus' crucifixion, if this had happened any other time of the year, it would not have unfolded the way that it did. Do you realize that? You see, Pontius Pilate, who had to give the final okay to crucify Jesus, didn't live in Jerusalem. He lived in Caesarea Maritima, which is 80 miles up the coast. So think about it. If they had to shuttle Jesus 80 miles up the coast and then back to Herod, back up the coast and so forth, it's going to take a fairly long period of time for this to all go down. So Pilate, however, would routinely make his presence known in Jerusalem during the major pilgrimage feasts, such as Passover. He would bring his armies, and they would be there as a show of strength, discouraging any major problems. Because they were amidst the Passover celebration, Pilate was there, and Jesus could be readily shuffled back and forth rapidly. Were this a month later, or earlier, the execution of Jesus would have been a drawn-out affair. But because of Pilate's presence in Jerusalem, it went down overnight. Never miss the fact, folks, that this was all within God's control. The Romans were unwitting allies, if you will, in carrying out God's plan of redemption. You realize that? They were unwitting allies in carrying out God's plan of redemption. So if we return explicitly now to the seven words, I'm not intending to reiterate what's already been said. I want to zero in on this final word. I think that we've got the words up here. You probably have heard these. Let's give some attention to the events that immediately preceded Jesus' death and the events that immediately followed his death. Let's really get a feeling for what's going on here. So let me encourage you to just really hunker down. Pretend that you were there almost 2,000 years ago and that you were a witness to what happened, that you were a witness to what was occurring. See, it was 9 o'clock in the morning when Jesus is nailed to the cross. Mark refers to it as the third hour. As time marches on, Mark in chapter 15, verse 33, reports that at the sixth hour, which is noon, the land was enveloped in darkness, which endured until the ninth hour. A non-biblical work called the Gospel of Peter says that the same phenomenon took place and that darkness held sway over all Judea and that all the people feared lest the sun set while Jesus was still alive. Big concern that the sun might set while Jesus was still alive. This is vitally important if you follow Deuteronomy chapter 21. Deuteronomy chapter 21, verses 22 and 23 stipulate, if a man has committed a crime punishable by death, and is put to death, and you hang him on a tree, his body shall not remain all night on the tree. But you shall bury him the same day, for a hanged man is cursed by God. You shall not defile your land that the Lord your God is giving you for an inheritance. The darkness here is very, very significant. This is one of these times in the message that you're going to feel like you're drinking from a fire hose. I want to talk about some of the interpretations that are out there regarding darkness. What this statement could mean here in the gospel. Okay, so bear with me. This stuff excites me. This stuff gets me lit up. So Luke is explicitly stating that the sun's light failed, leading some to postulate the occurrence of a solar eclipse. But an eclipse had taken place 4 years earlier, November 24th in 29 AD. And this could be no natural eclipse. It would have been impossible since Passover falls at the time of the full moon. Another explanation must be sought. And I believe that no matter how you slice it, this is not a natural phenomenon. This has God's fingerprints all over it. But frankly, more important than the cause of the darkness is what does it mean? What does it signify? I think there's potentially a number of viable explanations here with chains of meaning which explicate this darkness. First of all, Jesus in Luke 22:53, when he was arrested, spoke to the chief priests and the officers and said, "But this is your hour and the power of darkness." The overtone seems to be that of moral darkness, a theme popular in John 1 as well. There are also numerous examples throughout the scriptures of darkness arising as a fulfillment of prophecy. Isaiah 8:22 says, "And they will look to the earth, but behold distress and darkness, the gloom of anguish, and they will be thrust into thick darkness." In the Old Testament, the darkening of the sun was indeed a sign of judgment, which was oftentimes associated with the Old Testament concept of the day of the Lord. First century writer Philo saw such supernatural darkness as indicating the death of a great hero or the fall of an important city. This is echoed in Gentile thought as well. So, for example, darkness is said to have attended the death of Alexander the Great as well as Julius Caesar. I'm going to go somewhere you might not expect me to go in a sermon. I'm going to quote to you from a Roman poet, Virgil, for a moment. Listen to what he says. The thing I want you to grasp here, the thing that I really want you to get your hands around, is that no matter who you are, Jew or Gentile, darkness is not a good thing. I can think of one culture in the world for which darkness or black is a good concept. And that's Egypt. They call themselves the Black Lands because of the rich, fertile soil. But for everybody else, darkness was negative. It was ominous, all right? So here's what Virgil says. He says, "The sun will give you signs. Who dare say the sun falls? Nay, he oft warns that dark uprisings threaten, that treachery and hidden wars are upswelling. Nay, he had pity on Rome when after Caesar sank from sight, he veiled his shining face in dusky gloom, and a godless age feared everlasting night. The Jewish historian reflecting upon the death of Julius Caesar says, there were struggles of mankind in common against the unlawful acts against the gods from which we believe the sun turned away. If we return to the Old Testament, the prophet Micah asserts that darkness will come upon false prophets, rulers of Israel. You see, at its very core, I think it's impossible to escape the perception that darkness here is a clear reflection of the Father's verdict against the sins of the world. And as I said a moment ago, pick your poison, Roman or Jew, darkness is not a good thing. Darkness is an ominous sign. And this was palpable darkness, darkness you could feel. Reflect back to the time of the Exodus, when the plagues were being doled out against Egypt. You might remember the ninth plague, when darkness overtook Egypt for 3 days. Don't miss the symmetry here between the 3 hours and the 3 days. And if this wasn't enough, according to Luke, the veil of the temple was torn from top to bottom. Now, the rending of the temple, the veil that separates the temple from the interior precinct, the Holy of Holies, suggests now that all of us, everybody, has access directly to the presence of God, not simply the high priest once a year. All of us now, on an equal basis, can approach God because of the death of Jesus. So with one last cry, one last word, Jesus cuts through the darkness when he cries out with a loud voice and utters the seventh word, Father, into your hand I commit my spirit. Now, it's been said that we should not overly spiritualize the word, quote, spirit. If we dig deeply into this word translated spirit, it's the Greek word pneuma, which has a Hebrew background to it of ruach. Okay, pneuma and ruach. But ruach is the word also for breath in Greek, in Hebrew, and it's carried over into Greek as well. Jesus may simply be saying, I give my breath back to you, owing to the fact that in the ancient world, one's very breath was understood to be a gift from God. In light of that, notice Luke's final statement regarding Jesus' last words. And having said this, he breathed his last. Now, it's important here to recognize that Jesus' life breath was not smited by the Roman authorities, by the high priest, or the clamoring crowd. It was relinquished willingly to God. Jesus didn't die with a cry of abandonment, but with utter confidence in the one whom he addressed intimately as Father. Interestingly, Jesus' serenity in the face of death served as a model for Stephen, the first Christian martyr, who, as he is being stoned, prays, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. If we take the time to listen more fully to Jesus' seventh word, we gain an even deeper insight to his character. Again, with the statement, into your hands I commit my spirit, Jesus demonstrated what has been his lifelong connection with Jewish piety. Now, as we have seen many times before, Jesus' last words from the cross were not random, they were not happenstance. They were always purposeful, and many of them have direct antecedents in the pages of the Old Testament. And with this statement, he takes a leaf out of Psalm 31, verse 5. Into your hands I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. Jesus is doing more, much more here than turning a phrase based upon an Old Testament citation. He's also associating himself with the plight of the psalmist. Psalm 31 is the account of an individual who finds himself caught in the throes of supreme crisis. He is a man who finds himself amidst deep anguish, but comes out on the other end with assurance. The fact that this psalm hits a nerve is evidenced by the fact that the prophet Jonah refers to it during his troubles, and the prophet Jeremiah found himself haunted by a portion of verse 13. Now verse 5 becomes the source and content of Jesus' last word on the cross. But this association and importance runs much deeper than this. Psalm 31:5 is indeed a Jewish prayer that was typically prayed each evening before going to bed. A good Jew would offer this prayer on the off chance he might not wake up the next morning. So the last thing on his lips and mind before he drifted off to sleep was the entrusting of his life's breath to the Father. Remember the prayer that many of us learned as kids. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Okay, admittedly a bit macabre, but I think you get the point. It's been said that tomorrow is not promised to anyone. So it's a reasonable idea, whether you are praying this little prayer or Psalm 31:5, that our last thoughts before we drift off to sleep should be focused on our Creator. Psalm 31 is the account of a righteous sufferer crying out for deliverance from his enemies who are persecuting him. Here Jesus assumes the position of the righteous sufferer par excellence. We don't have time for a deep dive into this wonderful psalm, but I commend it to you as a way of augmenting your appreciation of Good Friday. This might have reflected the way Jesus felt in his final moment of yielding to the Father, because in the middle of it, Jesus is essentially saying, but nevertheless. You see, contrary to all the evidence of the violence and the mockery which surrounded the cross, Jesus is able to say, nevertheless. Nevertheless, I trust you, O Lord. I trust you finally against all the evidence of the power of death. I say, you are my God. Indeed, you are the one to whom I cried, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then in Psalm 31 again, this time verse 15, the psalmist affirms, my time is in your hand. Amazing. Jesus has likely prayed this psalm for as long as he can remember. And we see the psalmist and thereby Jesus affirming that God does have the whole world in his hands. And as he yields his spirit, we hear the echo of the psalmist's petition reverberating throughout the earth. Rescue me from the hands of my enemies and from my persecutors. Make your face shine on your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. With the words, into your hand I commit my spirit, Jesus takes his final breath and yields up his life. Here he's using Psalm 31 to express trust as he accepts his imminent death. And it's paramount that in the psalm, one entrusts his or her spirit to God, not simply in light of life's imminent end, but also in light of the deep conviction that life will and does continue. Jesus was confident that he would receive his spirit or his breath back. He was not relinquishing it forever. The same God that grants us life and will continue to give us life. So in Psalm 31:5, when it is said, into your hands I commit my spirit, it's the same thing as saying, my times are in your hand. On that Good Friday so many years ago, I don't think it ultimately mattered that day, at the end of the day, what side of the battle you were on. It was clear that something dramatic had happened. Witness the continued report of Luke the evangelist. Three responses followed Jesus' surrendering of his life to God. The first two could be viewed in parallel structure. First, the centurion. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, which parallels very well, when all the crowds saw what had taken place, they returned home beating their breasts. Consider first the centurion. This centurion, standing guard at the cross, a representative of the Roman Empire, witnesses Jesus' death and violent execution and is utterly overwhelmed. So much so that he declares, certainly, this man was innocent. The Greek word that appears here in Luke's gospel is the word dikaios. Dikaios. Interesting word. It can mean either innocent or righteous. You may recall that throughout the trial and crucifixion, Jesus is constantly referred to as an innocent sufferer. Look at Isaiah 53:11. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. The very crowds that demanded that Jesus be executed and clamored, crucify him, went home and beat their breasts. This is a sign of profound grief and mourning. They recognized that they had been instrumental in the execution of an innocent man. Mob rule reigned. Jesus died. The third group of bystanders was Jesus' acquaintances and women who accompanied him and, quote, watched these things. Certainly they were overcome with grief, yet they surely had no category to adequately explain what they had experienced, what had transpired before their very eyes. Now, in recognizing this, there's a sense in which we are there too. A biblical scholar, Walter Brueggemann, talks about the significance of this point. And he says this, we are partly the empire and its soldiers, recognizing who he was, but too late. We are partly the crowd, shrinking away in cowardice, but after we have contributed to nailing him to the cross. And finally, we are among his followers, bewildered by his death, moved by his courage and freedom. And again, we hear the words of the psalmist, our times are in your hand. 1968, archaeologists working at a site in northern Israel, a site called Givat HaMivtar, uncovered a cemetery from about the time of Christ. And in this cemetery, there were a bunch of bone boxes. They call them ossuaries. And in these bone boxes, they found this. This is the heel bone and the nail, the evidence of a man who had been crucified. This is the only physical evidence that survives today, that testifies to the brutality of crucifixion. This man by the name of John, likewise, in the first century, shared with Jesus the fact that he too had been crucified. So where do we find ourselves? The empire and its soldiers, recognizing who he was, but too late? Are we partly the crowd, shrinking away in cowardice, but after we have contributed to nailing him to the cross? Or are we his followers, bewildered by his death, and moved by his courage and freedom? Friends, as representatives of the empire, participants in the crowd, followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, we mercifully would not have to languish in this experience much longer. The unknown would not go on indefinitely. A new day would dawn, a bright new day, and all witnesses And as witnesses to all that transpired so long ago, we can now appreciate the empty tomb that much more profoundly because we have taken the time to linger on Friday. Can I ask you to stand? Let me close this with a word of prayer.